Well, good afternoon, everybody. We're going to get started. We expect some people will still be rolling in because this is rock and roll. You know how that is. We're recording today, so as we're proceeding through the presentation, if any of you would like to ask questions of the panel, I'd like to ask you to come up and go to the standing mic over there so that the video recording will pick up your question. Let me just begin by saying I'm Leslie Pilak. I'm the museum director of the Birmingham Historical Museum. And we've all come together today to recognize and remember Cream Magazine and its impact on American music culture. At the museum, we've created a unique exhibit dedicated to Cream and its heyday while publishing, out of Birmingham. And that exhibit has led to our recent acquisition of the most significant public Cream collection in the world. Today, we're celebrating that occasion in two ways. Later on, from 2 o'clock to 4 o'clock, the public's invited to join us at the museum for a special Cream party. So I hope you'll all stop in. And I do want to note that regular museum admission does apply, but we are having a party, and it should be well worth it. It's a family-friendly event. This presentation component of our celebration, though, is even more special. We're fortunate to have with us several individuals who worked with Cream before going on to further successful careers in the music industry. First, let me introduce Tom Weschler. Tom took up rock photography in the 70s and worked with Cream for many years. He was first a roadie and then road manager for Bob Seger, eventually co-authoring a book with Gary Graff about Seger called Traveling Man. Tom, who remains active in the field, has another book project in the works focusing on Detroit rock and roll. He's a guy who knows his rock photography, and we're so pleased he could be here today to talk about his experience with Cream during its years in Birmingham. Also with us to Tom's left is Bill Holdship. And Bill was with Cream Magazine in its later years. He went directly from the halls of Michigan State University into the halls of Cream Magazine in Birmingham, Michigan. And he'll be able to talk about Cream in the later years, and then also he went to LA with Cream when it moved there in the mid to late 80s. Next to Bill is Chris Victor, and Chris worked as an assistant to Barry Kramer and also in the mailroom at Cream. And like many people at Cream, she started in one place and moved somewhere else, but she stuck with it a long time. And so these are some of the long-term, I guess we would call them creamsters. And also, finally with us is Susan Whitehall. Susan was born in Philadelphia, but grew up here, making her a true Birminghamster. She graduated from Seaholm High School in 1970 and attended Michigan State, getting a degree in English. Her first full-time job as a young graduate in 1975 was at Cream Magazine. She was there during its golden years, working her way up quickly to become editor. She's been an award-winning journalist at the Detroit News since 1983 and has had two books published, Women of Motown, published by Avon in 1997, and Fever, Little Willie John's Fast Life, Mysterious Death, and the Birth of Soul, which was published by Titan Random House in 2011. I'd like to take a moment to mention the important role Susan has played in preserving the history of Cream Magazine. When the museum first hatched the idea of creating a Cream display for its current music exhibition, we had little information about Cream and no personal connections to draw from. Someone suggested I try to contact Susan Whitehall. Her enthusiastic response and guidance led to the development of a mock Cream office display with details she provided. She also coordinated a review of the exhibit by a number of former Cream staff and an oral history project. But even more significant has been her help connecting us to Charlie Oringer, Cream's longtime art director. That led to the loan of the best array of Cream artifacts ever displayed by a museum, and ultimately to Charlie's donation of his collection to the Birmingham Historical Museum to create a permanent archive. All of us in this room and everyone out there who values what Cream has contributed to American rock history owes a debt to people like Susan and Charlie who care deeply about Cream's legacy, because they were a part of forging it. We at the museum are privileged to help preserve that history for those of us who look back to remember those days, and for generations to come, the little Kramers out there, for example, who will want to study and learn more about it. At this point, I'm going to turn the program over to Susan and Tom and the rest of the panel, and Ben Edmonds just came in, so I don't want to overlook anything. Ben was editor and writer at CREAM in the early end of its lifetime, and so he can speak to a lot of those early years. So thank you for coming, Ben. So as I was saying, I'll turn this program over to Susan. We have the room until just shy of 2 o'clock, at which time I hope you'll head over to the museum and join us for a CREAM party. Thank you.
And I welcome everybody. It's like I'm looking out there and I'm seeing Birmingham school friends, I'm seeing CREAM folks, the Kramers, I'm so happy to see Connie and JJ and Jackson and Wendy. But to see everybody in one room is kind of amazing, and I know people are still coming over to the museum. I wanted to also point out Chrissy Victor next to Ben. Chrissy was in the mailroom, and then, you know, she was there for a lot of the cool stuff as well. And I'm not going to make you guys, when the Q&A happens, you can talk as much as you want. I hope you will. But Ben, I know, I'll just ask you if I'm right on something, and you can say yes or no. Okay? Because when it comes to some of the Cass Avenue stuff, you know. Can you guys hear me? All right. Louder? Is it okay now? Yeah? Okay. You all know what CREAM Magazine is looking out at this audience, but I just wanted to kind of talk to you about what it was at the time. At one time we were number two to Rolling Stone, and we didn't have to beg to get Keith Richards to pose for a boy howdy. They wanted to do it. The rock stars wanted to come to us. And the fact that this came out of this little office in Birmingham, and before that Walled Lake, and before that Cass Avenue, you know, it just shows you what's possible and how open and exciting the music scene was in Detroit back then, that we had such a thing. In fact, Ben came here from Boston just because the music scene here was so vibrant and so exciting. And it's kind of hard, you can see that happening again now with people being drawn to Detroit, but at the time in the early 70s, this was really the place to be as well. So, Leslie, I know, has said that this is a family-friendly exhibit. A lot of the stories, it's hard to be family-friendly and quote people accurately. I see that all except for young Jackson were adults here. So until my nephew and niece arrive, and they're used to it, there may be a bad word or two, but nothing really serious. Now, Grace Slick, we published without Le Boy Howdy over her. Oh, Boy Howdy's upside down. What? Yeah, we would publish things like that where she's exposing herself a little bit. We were a little edgy. That was all Charlie's fault. No. Anyway. And then, you know, Lennon, that was not solicited. He just... He thought it was a cool shirt.
Remember in that last interview he did that they published a few years ago, he said Buster was his favorite rock critic?
Hey, go up.
Well, I was just coming to soothe that there was a John Lennon interview that ran.
Closer.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Okay. I don't know if it's on because I couldn't get any closer. Okay.
It's on.
John Lennon, he did an interview that came out about maybe 2 years ago, and it was an unpublished interview that the guy did the day before he died, and he was very upset, so he never published it. And he said in that interview that he admired Lester Bangs. I thought that was an interesting thing.
Really cool?
Yeah.
Really cool. I think, Charlie, who did the Keith Richards Boy Howdy? Remember? You'll forget? I know they had to stay up all night with him to get that one. But oh, well. All right, now I'm a Birmingham girl. I've never heard Birmingham hamster before. But this is where it started for me, with going to see the Beatles in 66 with my Derby friends, Lynn Branica and Tina Tracy, her sisters in the audience. And I was a crazy music crazy kid. I didn't think I was any music crazier than anyone else, but you know, this, I went to see the Beatles twice. Okay, and I saw the Monkees too, but Bill and I know that's cool.
I was there.
He was there too. We didn't know each other, but Cream's first issue was when I was still in high school, March 1969, and the Cream came out of a lot of Wayne State students. It came out of the Cass Corridor. It came out of Barry Kramer and Dave Marsh,
Tony Ray,
and you know, it was Dave Marsh was there at the beginning. We were just talking by email, and it was, you know, they really, the foundation was in the Cass era. And even though Dave was saying Cream became more popular in its Birmingham era, Wald Lake and Birmingham, really the foundational aspects, what it stood for, was really in those early days. And even though Dave says modestly, well, when people make a fuss over him, because he was a former editor of Cream, he says, but you're thinking of the Cream after me. Still, you know, the foundational, the goals of the magazine were there early on, and what they wanted to do, which was to be funny, but also to be deadly serious about what they were writing. The journalism was extremely important. I can't stress that enough, that even though it was a delightfully funny thing to read, you know, we were very painstaking about copy editing, about everything being just right, about the writing being top notch. And sometimes that gets lost. It gets lost because people think, for instance, that Lester was sloppy, and he really wasn't. Lester was the best copy editor I ever had on my copy. Now, you know, Mr. Dream Whip and Mr. Boy Howdy, R. Crumb, the apocryphal story is that he was in Detroit and he needed money for a medical issue, whether it's apocryphal or not, and he was paid, this may not be true, $25 for Boy Howdy. So there we have our mascot.
Which, as I understand it, when he turned in Boy Howdy, nobody was particularly thrilled with it. You know,
it's, that's what Barry always said.
It's,
I know,
something that has become iconic after the fact.
Exactly. Yeah, it's okay. Whatever. That wherever you know. These are just some of the covers that were great. You know, here Jimmy Page is intently reading a cover story on him, and Robert. Now, this is the Cass office. Now, weren't you guys in the house first before this?
What house?
Okay, you weren't?
In what house particularly are you talking about?
A house.
No.
On Cass. That was it. That was
that
the first
was
one. Okay.
That was it. As far as I remember, Connie, is that true? That was the first one, right? There was nothing before that.
Okay.
Before that, there was nothing.
Richard Pinkston.
Right, in the basement.
We couldn't get Connie to sit up here, but we'll ask her anyway.
Right.
Mixed Media, for those of you who don't know, was the head shop. Back then we had head shops in the 60s where they would sell all sorts of paraphernalia, and Barry managed it, Barry Kramer. So he started it sort of in the basement of Mixed Media, and then from there they went into the second and third floor of this Cass Avenue chateau. And I hear that they would throw the key down. Yeah, if you wanted to get in, you would yell up and they would throw a key down to the outside, and there you'd go on your merry way. The top floor is where Mitch Ryder would rehearse. Mitch was being managed by our publisher, Barry Kramer, at that time. So it was kind of a wild place. And then there was a little store in the first level. Now, Dave Marsh was allegedly held up in the store, or was it the dry cleaner?
Before my time.
It did happen. Yeah.
Is that building still there?
No.
There's Rick Siegel. I thought Eric would be here, and then there's Lester. And is that might be one of Charlie's VW vans. There's Lester and Dave in downtown Detroit at a newsstand. Here's the, isn't that amazing? I love this one. It's Barry Kramer on the left. There's Dave Marsh in the middle and Lester on the right. That is Cass Avenue, but that's not the building, obviously. That's not where Cream was. Lester at the ABX barbecue. There's Dave interviewing John Entwistle of The Who. Now, Dave said something I wanted to point out about his view of what Cream was at the time. He said it was both a humor magazine, or always humorous, and still the most serious rock writing then or maybe ever. Not the most pontifical or pretentious, but the most serious. Change the world serious, change yourself serious, get these motherfuckers out of my sight serious. Richard Pinkston, who I'm in touch with again, he was when he was just 15 years old, he used to write for Cream in the Cass days. Richard said, the beauty of Cream was that all these nuts, all these flawed people made this cool thing. When somebody who knows what's what finds out that you worked at Cream, it's like telling them you were part of the Algonquin Round Table. It really means something. I don't need another guy telling me you wrote for Rolling Stone. So what? Who didn't? So, that reminds me of one of those Bill Rauhauser photos. Have you seen any of Bill's shots of downtown Detroit? There's Lester and there's Barry Kramer. It almost looks like Lafayette Coney Island or something. That was a party for the Faces backstage, and that's Mike Stone, exactly.
Ex-husband.
Yeah. Small world. It's Chrissy. Mike is Chrissy's ex-husband, that's right. Mike Stone was the longtime Warner Brothers rep, so of course he was backstage at the Faces show. Now, this Faces show, that happened to be the first Cream party I ever went to. Although, first I should probably say how I got to Cream, briefly. I was, after I graduated from State, what am I going to do? English degree, oh my God. I drove my little MG up to the Little Professor bookstore in downtown Birmingham. I was in there talking to Gene, the owner, co-owner, and I happened to pick up a Cream in the newsstand. I was reading it, and I looked, and it said 187 South Woodward. I'm like, where is this? And he goes, oh, those assholes, they're upstairs. they're always bouncing checks on me, you know, but they'll come down here a lot. You know, Elmore Leonard comes down here as well. But I took it home, I bought it, and then I started writing letters to the editor at the time, who was Wayne Robbins. Little did I know that the power seat was really Lester and Jan Uhelski. But at any rate, I got a lunch with Wayne. He encouraged me to hang out with everybody. He said, you have to hang out with us before you kind of get assignments. I'm like, oh, whatever. So I did. After a bit of this, Jan took me aside, Jan Uhelski, and said, he's not going to give you any assignments. I'll give you an assignment. So that's what happened. And then she gave me assignments for what was we called Extra Cream, which was our local supplement that was regional for, it was for Michigan, Canada, whatever. And then Lester would give me record assignments too, which I was always, I think, better at features than record reviews, but he was really, he really helped me develop as he did many of us as a writer. So, then I went in and talked Barry Kramer into hiring me full time. I told him, you know what, instead of paying me freelance, why not just hire me and I'll do Extra Cream and Jan won't have to do it. And he actually, I think he was ready for me to ask him this because he had this plan that, he said the state of Michigan will pay half your salary if I take you off unemployment, thanks to Governor Milliken. So thank you, Governor Milliken. For the first 6 months, Cream only had to pay half my salary. Now here's Jan with her last name misspelled. I didn't do that. And Lester. There's Dave. I don't know if any of you listen to Dave. Dave has a radio show on Sirius XM on the left on Saturday mornings at 10. It's really worthwhile. There's Barry and Connie. Many, if not most of these are beautiful photos are by Charlie Oranger, who won't sit up here with us, but there's Ben. I have the same top.
It used to
be mine.
Ben was always a fashion plate, and then there's Lester above him. Now there's Charlie. Charlie.
He looks the same.
Yeah, he does.
He does.
Charlie was, we would often be in opposition. Being an editorial meant that we were the jerks who were late with our copy and all that. And Charlie was in charge of production as the art and photo director, so he'd come stomping down the hallway when we were, by the time we were at Birmingham, we had a long hallway dividing editorial and photo, demanding the copy, wanting to know what was going on. And anyway, he was the guy who got things done. Picture of yours, Leslie Brown on the left, who was one of our secretaries, Jan Uhelski again, I know how to spell her name, and Connie on the right. And I don't know who they're messing with. Who is it? It's Leslie West. I knew it was a big guy. Leslie West of Mountain. There's Barry and Connie. One thing that Jan and I really, when Jan was going to come in, and we always appreciated that women were given more than a shot at Cream. And we always appreciated that Barry did this. Connie was always a very important part of Cream as well. And so we were kind of empowered as women. This, I thought everything was like that, but from what I hear, Rolling Stone wasn't quite the same, and definitely mainstream magazines, it wasn't like that either. So Connie was our, she was our advertising director, and then she was assistant publisher, and Jan and Robbie Kruger were there before me, and Georgia Criscow. So we had a lot of women, and even if the women became as important as the men, like Dave Marsh said he had to push Barry on it a little, but Barry agreed with it, and he was all the way behind us as females. There's Connie. I don't know where this one was taken, but
back of the of the Cass Avenue.
That's in back of Cass Avenue, as Ben says. It's just a cool shot.
See, it's all caps.
We're not there anymore. Now here's Dave Dixon. I don't know how many of you guys remember the Air Races, but there's also a Birmingham connection with Dave. He graduated from Birmingham High School before it was named Seaholm in the early days. When Dave was he'd always come by the office a lot, even in Birmingham days when I was there. But that's an early issue of Cream, and obviously an early time. Dee De Leron was an early contributor to Cream, and later on he was our attorney. Barry used to love to brag that we had a mob attorney, which he was. So he had the mafia and he had us. That's also, I think, in the Cass area. Now there is the farmhouse in Walled Lake. That's where they moved next. I see. The farmhouse was before my time as well. It only lasted, what, 2-3 years? And then in 1972 is when they came to Birmingham. But here's Lester interviewing Ted Nugent. There's a Lester with, that's out at the Alice Cooper farm, shooting guns off. Hippies with guns, why not? There's Barry relaxing backstage at a outdoor rock show. Goose Lake. Good call, Goose Lake. Now that's a recent picture, I'm sorry about that, and it doesn't show it properly. I gotta get Charlie or someone to get a better picture of the where we were in Birmingham. Where we were was to the left of the marquee, and those first three windows were where the secretaries were. The second three windows were editorial. And then at the end of the block, right above what is still the first door, Serezny and Offnen, was the photo art department. So we, when I came in 1975 at some point, and I know at what point, it was like spring. It's hard to sometimes nail these down because we didn't have a staff box at a certain point, and then Robert Duncan insisted we needed a staff box. That came in about the same time that I did. But one thing I well remember Barry getting on us about that had to do with those windows, or when President Ford had a motorcade and it was coming through downtown Birmingham, and it was going to make the turn right there at where the apartments are, right at the Birmingham Theater. So he made it very clear to us in very graphic language that if anybody made any sort of sign or motion out the window or opened the window or did anything stupid, that bad things would happen to us. And that wasn't just the Secret Service. He would not be happy. That's me in front of what used to be, I stole this from Alan Stamm. It's me in front of what used to be our door to go upstairs to 187 South Woodward. It looks much, much cleaner and chicer now. In our days, it was just a plain old glass door. And if you know Birmingham, you know the Hyde Park Steakhouse is all in the lower level where the bookstore used to be and all that. Extra Cream is what I was telling you, that was my first gig. And it was a great little thing. Apparently, Chad from the Chili Peppers, I know he's part of the Birmingham exhibit. I guess he was an avid reader of Extra Cream, and we had the listings and all that. And it lasted for a couple of years anyway. And I did, there's Patty, and that's Dan Carlisle. It gave us a chance to write about the local scene and not just the national. I mean, we were a national magazine, so. And that was my first cover story, so I had to put that in. Lester hated Peter Frampton. No big surprise. So this is just a sign to you, though, of the kind of editor he was and mentor. He put aside all that and helped me with my Frampton story. You know, like he said, okay, he's a cute chipmunk or something. And he says, okay, well, what is it about this cute chipmunk that we're trying to say here? And, you know, he'd help me with the, you know, putting it out in a narrative form and making sure I hit all the high points and whatever. And thank you, Lester. That's Joe Jackson reading us with me. I was giving him his cover story. Now, this is a, yes, we had a close relationship with Kiss. And this was the infamous incident when we unmasked them took their pictures and put their pictures in without their makeup. That's the bathroom, the men's room at Cream, our chic 1920s bathroom. And Charlie, didn't you take the picture? Yeah. They were pretty pissed off at us after we put their pictures in without their makeup on, but they knew we were doing it. That's Robbie Krueger. She was one of the other early women at Cream. That's me having my head eaten by Lester. And that's Robert Duncan on the left. When I first started, Wayne Robbins was the editor. Then he left, and Robert Duncan came in as editor. And Lester was always senior editor, but what people don't always understand is he didn't take care of the bureaucratic details of being the editor. Duncan did that. Duncan did the writer's money. Duncan did a lot of the stuff that Lester didn't want to bother with, was too bored to do. So it was a good little co-editor thing that those two had. They would like have these manifestos. We'd go down to Pasquale's, and after we had been done writing all day and all night and editing, and they'd sit there and talk about what we wanted Cream to be and how it was. We had the highest aspirations for it, and nothing was in our way. We were going to do all this cool stuff. And I would just be there going, yeah, 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 sure, whatever you say. So I loved being number third in that little trio. That was big fun. That was also the era when Eric Genheimer was first our mail boy, and then he was assistant editor. We used to take rock stars all around Birmingham. This is me with Phil Lynott. I think this, didn't you take this shot? This is a Tom Weschler shot. At Peabody's. So, Birminghamites, they never knew who we were likely to be pulling in these places. Phil Lynott and Thin Lizzy, they did The Boys Are Back in Town, and he's, of course, died a little too early, sadly. I think that's Karen Civelli, and then there's the record guy. Strip Matter, Jim. And the record guys would bring up whoever it was, Tom Petty or the Runaways or whoever. Sometimes we'd meet him in the office, but a lot of times we'd go to the Midtown or to Peabody's. Not as often there. This was in the art department, the photo art department at Cream, which was, of course, over Sresny and off in Furs. Oops, sorry. I can't go back either. You know, the whole Detroit sucks thing is Lester didn't hate Detroit, but it was like part of his shtick. And he always wanted to be the provocateur. He loved that shirt. It was, you know, it was what it was. I remember on this particular day, we were just bored, and he managed to fashion plastic eyeballs that he thought looked cool, especially with the, you know, the stripes from the Venetian blind, made it look like a jail or something. That was also taken down in the photo department. And this is another, we were always playing in the photo department. This is in photo. We had no business in photo. This is Charlie's domain. But there's Lester, and Eric, as I told you, was our mailboy and then assistant editor, and there's Robert Duncan. At that point, Charlie had he had a jukebox right behind Lester there. That's, I think, in the Brown Street house. At one point, Lester, and when everybody moved to Birmingham in 72, there was a house on Brown Street where they lived communally. And that was interesting. When I came along, there was another communal house that a few of them were living in over on Park Street. I'm sure that was really popular with the neighbors. Not only have hippies in there, but cream staffers. But at that point, you know, Birmingham was just a much more diverse place in terms of income levels because you had a lot of these older houses in the downtown area that hadn't been fixed up. They hadn't been torn down for Bigfoots. And some of them were a little, you know, rough around the edges, some of these old Victorians. So those are the kind of houses you had a lot of music people in, a lot of hippies, whatever. So it was easier to live economically in downtown Birmingham. Robert.
Like our two houses on Danes and Purdy.
The Bob Seger office that's still there. It's probably the most ghetto house in Birmingham.
It hasn't changed since 71.
Yeah.
I found it in 71, and it still looks the same.
It still looks the same, yeah. Yeah, they have not fixed that house up. And that's another thing. You know, the Seeger guys were always just a short walk away from the cream office, so we would meet at the Midtown.
Not interchangeable.
a lot of common parties and a lot of interchangeable stuff. But, no, I can't stress enough, though, how Birmingham was really kind of a wild, loose place back then compared to the way it is now. It's you really have to have a lot of money to live there. We always had a good relationship with the Jay Giles Band, and here Lester is appearing on stage playing typewriter with Peter Wolfe. He's looking a little worse over wear there. And there is Miss Jan Uhelski being chased up the aisle by Fee Wee Bell of the Tubes. We were... especially Jan was always game for getting involved in onstage shenanigans. She famously appeared with Kiss, dressed up and painted up as a Kiss member on stage. Now this was the first, I put this in, it's a Charlie Oranger photo from Cobo Hall when David Ruffin jumped up on stage with Rod Stewart and the Faces. That Faces show was an incredible thing, especially for me because it was the first big rock star party I ever went to as a cream staffer. Because we were backstage, because Lester was always invited backstage. If you were with Lester, you were in. And Ronnie Wood, of course, was in the Faces then. Ronnie was there with Bobby Womack, who you music fans will know is the famous R&B singer. Bobby was just sort of traveling with the Faces as sort of their mascot, friend, whatever. So at some point, Bobby knew that David was having a party, and he said, you guys are invited, you want to come? And Ronnie said to us, hey, you guys want to come to David Ruffin's house? And we're like, yeah. So we got there. I couldn't believe it. We were these scruffy rock kids wearing jeans and T-shirts, and everybody at Ruffin's party was extremely elegantly dressed, and he was expecting Rod. Rod was with what's her name, Britt at that time. And so that's all he wanted to do, you know, commune with Britt and go back to the hotel. But we went, Lester and I, with Eric Genheimer, we went along with Ronnie and Bobby Womack. And we stayed all night, and we danced and ended up in a back room singing and playing guitar. We were all singing with David Ruffin. And Lester was making up songs. Some of them were kind of rude too, but anyway, that I thought if this is a normal work week, what this is going to be wild. This is what I was describing. This is Jan with Kiss, so she doesn't have the Kiss makeup on here. Ah, Leslie. I don't know if Leslie is here yet, is she? Leslie was one of our secretaries. She's a longtime friend, too, of Connie and Jan's. Now, this is a photo shoot that we did in a Birmingham park. Well, yeah, drunk cheerleader in a Birmingham park with a bunch of bottles around her. I'm sure they loved us in Birmingham. You know, the police used to come up and say, why are you guys parked on the street at 2 a.m.? You can't park. You know, we were outside the Birmingham Theater right there. You can't park here after 2. And we're like, we're on deadline. They said, park in the structure. I said, we're supposed to walk to the structure at 4 or 5 in the morning. At any rate, I don't know that we ever resolved that. But that's on the left. That's from the photo shoot with Leslie, who is our secretary. And then on the right, that's the final shot we used on the cover. That's me at some point when we had mostly women as editors, Kathy Giese and Linda Barber at the time. And it just happened to be they were the ones who applied for the jobs and had the skills we needed. And then they left almost at the same time, really in a short period of time. And I had to put an ad. I didn't have to. I put an ad in the Michigan State News. Why? Because I'm a loyal Spartan. I wanted to give a Spartan a job. I admit it. So here we go. Here are the guys. Yeah. So as a result of that ad up at the State News, Dave DiMartino, top left, answered the ad. He came in and it was great. He had such a deep knowledge of music, you know, and it really meshed well because he had knowledge of music that I either didn't care about or didn't, whatever. He was there. He was obsessive about his favorites, as you know. And then he had a friend. He knew a guy, Bill Holdship, who also needed a job, and we had an opening. So that really worked out very well because Bill also had a real deep knowledge of music. And in fact, Bill's taste and mine really meshed a lot. We would have more in common than not. But still, it was really a good synergy in terms of we all had sort of different interests, but they synced. And then John Kordosh in the middle there, I like to take claim for him because I really think I started him as a freelance writer because I love the Mutants. But then he didn't come in as a full-time editor until just when I was leaving. I went to the Detroit News in 1983. That was like a year after our publisher, Barry, died. And, yeah, I think that was around the timetable. Lester died in 81. Barry died in 82. I always get those two confused.
Sue?
So, Chrissy.
I remember Dave's interview when he showed up to the office. He was wearing that lime green suit.
A lime green suit.
Yeah, I remember that.
Oh, my God. I totally forgot about that. And that's out of sequence, but that is Lester in the Birmingham office. In later years, Bill, I think, I forget who was there, but at any rate, Bill, he never had the window office. Lester didn't care about that. He wanted to be by the stereo. And he had all sorts of crazy stuff. You can see his Selectric there. It's much like the Selectric you'll see over at the museum. And he had to be in charge of the stereo, and I think he wore that shirt most days. But Connie, I think you corrected me on when Barry died. 81, yeah. And then,
Yeah.
See, I always am dyslexic about those two deaths for some reason. It was it was a traumatic time to lose Lester and Barry, and it's like which one happened? Ugh.
Yeah, it was because I was working at Cream by the time Lester died.
I know. That particular. We were National Magazine, but we of course did the local favorites, and we had that framed in the outer office. And Bill, do you remember when someone came running in our outer office one day, some fan, and tore it off the wall and just stole it?
Yeah. Running
down the stairs with it. Yeah. So now there is our little reunion that happened in the spring. we did a little oral history at the museum, and there's Jan Uhelski on the right. She made it in. Ben next to, there's a kind of a stand-up of Lester we have, and there's Chrissy, and then there's Leslie Brown, our drunk cheerleader at the bottom. That's sort of near, we're near the area that they had a mock-up of the cream desk. And this is where we were back in the day. There's Jan is holding the cake, Jan Uhelski, and then there's Lester with his arm around her. Doug Mum to Lester's other side, he was one of our art layout guys. And then he's got his arm around me. And then that little girl in front of me is one of our typesetters, Nancy. Eric Genheimer, our mailboy, is behind me, and assistant editor. The guy in, above Tom is, I mean above Doug is, this guy Tom that was with us for a short period of time, I never can remember his last name. And the guy on top is Michael Marks, who was our only staff photographer. Nobody else was a staff photographer. Oh yeah, Harvey Zupke on the left was advertising director and for Extra Cream. And what? Oh yeah, I save Eric for last. You may wonder why a child was in our office. There's no place for a child. The child that Lester is holding there is Eric Siegel, who is the son of Rick Siegel, our comptroller. Rick had been there from almost the beginning, and Sue Siegel, his mother, also was kind of our head secretary, so Eric was in the office more often than not, after school especially, and probably not the best place for a child to be, but he's turned out all right. I think he's going to be at the museum at least. Is Eric there? No. He'll be at the museum. Oh, sorry. And there again, you can see Robert Duncan up in the middle. He flew all the way from San Francisco in the spring to be at the museum to take part in the little oral history we did. We were videotaped talking about Cream and Barry and just everything. And he's got his arm around Eric Genheimer. That's what he looks like today. And there's Bill on the right, Ben Edmonds on the left. Esther, Jan in the middle, me on the right, and Chrissy and Leslie on the left. That sort of gives you an idea what the exhibit looks like. Oh yeah, and we all had a great relationship with Jay Giles. There I am with Peter Wolf. And there's Robbie, the drunk chauffeur. He's got a beer in his hand. Yeah, it was the 70s. Nobody seemed to mind. Nobody got killed. I don't know how. And that's me, and that gives you an idea of what was behind Lester's desk. This was the office in 187 South Woodward. The Free Press took this picture of me. John Collier, they did a Sunday magazine piece on what people in the music business in Detroit had as their stereo set. So, of course, we had this really funky, pretty cheap set, which was, I thought, funny. It would be funny for them to see this. And of course, it was over Lester's desk. I think it was a Pioneer, and it got a lot of rough usage, to say the least. After some time, we insisted that Lester had to have headphones because he would play Metal Machine music at full volume in the morning. And then he would, when I wasn't looking, he would spike my coffee with Romalar, which, not funny because I don't like anything sweet in my coffee. But some of the stuff behind me is Lester's doing. Like there's a Carly Simon photo. There's, Judy Garland when she was all drugged out, messed up. And then there's a cover of Cream. We used to make up fake covers of Cream. There's a Love Doll cover of Cream over to the right that's definitely not family friendly. We would put all that stuff up on the wall. And that reminds me, one time we would proofread the issue 2 and 3 times. Typeset copy, corrected copy, and then the final issue would be stapled together, and we would all look at it one more time. And we had to have 3 editor signatures on each one, and then usually Connie and Barry was the last person to look at it. So we decided to test him, kind of the way that Van Halen tests their rider backstage by specifying no red M&Ms or whatever. So what we did, or I should say Lester did, and we went along with it, is he would change things in the table of contents page. And he would change them to rude things. Instead of America's Only Rock and Roll Magazine, it would be America's Only Blah Magazine. And I'll just let you think of what it could be. And, so we'd put that in, and we would all sit there, and we'd take it into Barry's office, and it would be like, okay, one, two, three, four. We'd be counting off how long it would take until the explosion came. And it would be like, boom! Barry came running in. He's like, you jerks! I had a better word than that. If that had gotten through, this whole magazine would be over. You'd be out of jobs. What are you thinking? But we knew that he was looking at every word. Obviously, that was a clue. There's Barry in the office, and there's young JJ. JJ's here today on Amira's lap. Amira was our comptroller accountant at that point.
She was great.
Amira?
Uh-huh. That was her last name, Skocilas.
Skocilas, thank you. Yeah, we once got mad, the editors at Amira, because it was all the other secretaries were gone. The phone was ringing and ringing, and we were yelling, Amira, answer the phone. And she's like, no. Barry told me I need to interject. She was Israeli, right?
Yes.
And she had a thick accent. She was going, no, Barry told me I didn't have to answer the phone. And we're like, answer the goddamn phone. We all answer the phone. So the next day, Barry comes in and goes, you assholes, I told her not to answer the phone because no one can understand her.
I want my dread card.
There's my little nephew. That's the kids have really enjoyed the Selectric over at the museum. And they asked people to type stuff up. They got a Selectric that's a little too new, but that they need one that works anyway. That is what it looks like over there, and you guys have questions. We got lots of time to answer. Yep. Yeah. Carlton.
How's that?
Oh, and introduce yourself, too.
Hello? Better?
Oh, that's kind of weird.
It's pretty bad. I'll keep my voice up high. How about that? Thank you. My name is Carlton Goles. I work at the Detroit Sound Conservancy. And my question was, with extra creams, I actually didn't know that.
Oh, you didn't?
And so I'm just wondering, is there a full set of those? How many were there?
Yeah. Charlie donated, as you'll see at the museum, he donated all of his creams to the Birmingham Historical Museum. I think all of those would have had extra cream in them, right, Charlie? Yeah.
They started in 74, didn't they? They ended in 76.
That would be about right, because I came in 75, and I know I only had to work on it for about a year, almost less than a year. So it was like a year and a half or 2 years, I want to say. And they were yellow, and it was stapled inside the magazine and went to Canada, Northern Ohio, and Michigan, Southeast Michigan. So when you buy them online, you won't necessarily get the one with extra cream in it if it's not from here. Carlton, I got to tell you guys, is doing a great job with the Detroit Sound Conservancy. They are trying to conserve and preserve anything about Detroit music history, especially about music writers and the stuff that we did. And they've got a website and everything, and it's a lot of cool stuff. Any other questions? Nah. Yeah.
Mine's more of just a comment.
Not that it's working.
I just got to say how important Cream Magazine. Oh, God, I'm going to cry right now.
Check.
There you go.
I'm 45 years old, and growing up, Cream introduced me to everything, and mainly because I was a Kiss fan, and I saw Kiss on the magazine cover, but then it opened up all these other things to me. And Ben, I know reading old issues and things you wrote about the Stooges or the MC5 just means so much. You know, Bill, I can remember this one issue, Rock Revolution, a picture of John Lennon with the Boy Howdy t-shirt on. It was like at the beginning of the magazine. Susan, just amazing things. And the Stooges and the MC5, I think, are just some of the greatest gifts that rock and roll ever had or gave us. And so Cream is synonymous with that to me. Mm-hmm. And but what's really important as a kid in the late 70s and early 80s was that you couldn't find some of these bands in Rolling Stone. You couldn't find them. I mean, there was other magazines like Circus, but that was always kind of like a subpar Cream as far as I was concerned, you know? But it just, I learned so much. And there was one issue, the New Wave issue, it was like 82 or 83. Yeah. This one magazine, you guys don't know me, and I don't know why you care what I'm saying, but I'm just telling you, it's so important to me. This one magazine introduced me to Iggy and the Stooges, to the Sex Pistols, to the Ramones. I mean, I have all my issues still. And my wife is like, when the hell are we getting rid of these things? But I no way.
Well, at least donate them to somebody.
They're not going anywhere.
Yeah.
I mean, I have that one issue, and I'll go down, and I'll file through, and I'll try and find.
You know, because of the Michigan State connection, you know, Bill went there, and sort of Dave and I. And
me too.
Yeah. Well, there are a bunch of things up there in the Pop Cultural Library. They have some issues of Cream up there.
I just got to say thank you. It means so much to me what you guys did and were a part of. And I'm so proud to be from Michigan to have things like Cream and the Stooges and the MC5. It's just wonderful. I'm so excited to be here and see you guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, Bill, what was your first impression when you got hired in at Cream?
That was a long time ago.
Get close.
I do remember that Dave called me because the editorial assistant before me had left, and he said, hey, you want a job? And I came down, and I went and had lunch with you and Dave. And
Microphone.
I went and had lunch with Dave and Sue, and it seemed like it was going to be a real job and stuff like that, and I was real happy. And Connie was the one that was going to have to give the final okay, and she was out of town. And I remember Harvey's upkeep came in and said, who's this? You said, it's Bill. He's going to work here. Harvey looked at me and said, don't expect to make much money. But then I was a little nervous about that, but then Connie came back and hired me, and everything was cool. It was, I don't know, I was just so excited to be at Cream Magazine because I grew up reading it in high school, and I was just like, I mean, like, if you'd have told me I was going to be working at Cream Magazine someday, I would have said, when I was like 14, 15 years old, I'd have said, oh my God, all my dreams will come true. I won't want another thing in life. So I was just thrilled to work. I was just thrilled to work there. I mean, I was the little man on the totem pole, as you know, so I had to do the transcribing and everything like that.
Yeah, I did that
good
too.
Good training, very good training.
I did that too, exactly. So what about Chrissy? What was your wildest story?
Oh, I'll write my memoirs one of these days. I don't know, there were a few. But
the male kids saw everything.
Yeah, I think, my first day, actually, the way I got hired at Cream was pretty interesting. My boyfriend at the time saw an ad in, I don't know, the Detroit News, the Free Press, some paper, and it said something along the lines of, you know, good vibes, cool place, crappy pay. And my boyfriend recognized the phone number or something like that, and he's like, that's Cream Magazine, you got to go and apply for this job. So I headed up to the Birmingham Theater, and behind the desk was Sue Siegel, who was this Amazonian redheaded woman. And I was 18 years old, something like that. And I'm like, oh my gosh, what am I doing here? And Sue says, what do you want? And I said, well, I'm here for the job. And she said, do you know how to type? I said, yeah. She goes, do you know how to alphabetize? I said, yep. She says, do any of these words offend you? And she rattled off every four-letter word that she could think of. And I'm like, no. She goes, you're hired. Get in the mailroom. And that was my first day at Cream.
You know, that reminds me, Sue Siegel, who is our Amazonian redhead head secretary, my first day after I got hired by Cream, you think I would have known by then, by the time they hired me, kind of the way things were? No. I was dressed like a little Birmingham girl, all dressed up for my first day of work. Even though it was like 1970s, I had all my platform shoes and bell bottoms, but still. I arrived, I think, at 10 o'clock or something. There's nobody in editorial. The secretaries were laughing at me, and not only that, but editorial was locked. So I had to sit in the outer office with them. Sue Siegel could have let me in. I don't know why she didn't, but she waited until Lester got there with the key. And there was this big flourish. Lester would get the key out and open the door, and then business would start. So this is my second day. I didn't arrive quite so early.
on my second day, Jack Kronk, who was head of the mailroom at the time, took me out to, I forget, the Mexican restaurant up Woodward, and got me drunk on margaritas. And we were there for, I don't know, 2 hours or so, when we came back, and Sue just laid into us. And she was screaming at Jack, and she was just like, you're going to be fired, I'm going to dock your pay. And Jack was giving her the finger and swearing. I thought, this might be my last day at Cream. But
and you found out that, no, it wasn't.
It was just another day at Cream.
Yeah, I know. I saw a few things like that. You know, Barry, well, first, I told you that Lester was the best copy editor ever. I had heard about Lester when they hired me, and so I thought he was going to be this scary guy. But when I went into the office, he was always the happy, friendly guy with puppy dog eyes, you know. And it was like, he basically came to town to do a story on a freelance on, I think it was the Alice Cooper story. It was one of those. And he just never went back. He never went home. But and Barry, Barry, not only did he give women opportunity, he was this intense guy. I can't overemphasize. He was always working, and he was always working the phone, always getting stuff done. He could do our jobs, though, as well as we could. Maybe not as well as we thought we could, but he knew how to do it. You know, my story about his copy editing, finding the little things that we left in copy for him to find. So... Weschler.
Yes.
He
yes, ma'am.
Mr. Weschler, what was your wildest Cream story?
Getting on the masthead, finally. I had taken photographs since I stopped working for Bob in about 74.
He's talking about Bob Seger.
I knew Charlie from, we were both roadies for bands back in the day, and I kept asking him, you got an assignment for me? You want me to shoot something? And finally he started letting me shoot some pictures for Cream, and I'd give him their photos. I did a really cool one of the Romantics one time, I remember, with all this color stuff on it. And I said, do I ever get on the masthead? And the magazine came out, no Tom Weschler, came out finally. I think it was the Led Zeppelin cover in 78. Bingo, my name was on the masthead. I was relegated at Cream with my partner Omar Newman. We had a photo studio across the street. We were relegated to shooting the black and white of the covers in the back issues. That's what we did, basically. But once in a while, we got out to get out there and shoot rock and roll. Then they let me do the beer thing. That was fun.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, so you know, people would come and go like Tom. We had a lot of... We had a lot of photographers.
Transients.
Huh? Transients, yeah. But that we usually, we would pretty much have four editors at one time, four full-time writer editors. And we had four desks in the Birmingham office. That's the way it was. And then the mailroom, whether it was Chrissy or Jack or Eric, they were behind us. So
I just want to say one thing. Even though my tenure there was sporadic, it was a pleasure working there and having the memories of going upstairs and then going to the Midtown with Barry and drinking Courvoisier and hanging out and going across the street with her in a rock and roll band to shoot pictures from the balcony. That kind of thing those are the memories that, you know, keep you going. And Cream Magazine was absolutely a part of the rock and roll world, not only in Detroit, but in the United States and all over the world. Cream's, you know, go Cream, right on.
Yeah. What he said was, how many people worked full-time at Cream in the early 70s period? I came in 75. Connie can correct me, but I think we had about 19. Does that sound too much? Yeah, by the time we got to Birmingham, what was it, 12, 15? That sounds about right. But you know, when people say they worked at Cream, more often than not, they're talking about being a freelancer at some point. There weren't that many of us that were full-time staffers. Four editors, Barry and Connie, Harvey, Richard Siegel, and then we'd have two mail clerks, and then we'd have Charlie in the art department. Our typesetting was sort of outsourced, but we'd usually have one or two, one typesetter. But there weren't a lot of us. And, you know, it's like whenever I read stuff about Cream, inevitably, if it's by someone who wasn't there directly, there's not much relation to truth. So it's like anything, as I learned in, God knows, 31 years of newspapering. If it's not a direct source, someone who actually worked at Cream, you can pretty much forget it. Hi, Alan Madlin. He was our editorial assistant. In fact, he drove the car when we took Bruce Springsteen over to Greektown. We almost killed him. Family friendly.
Yeah, he was kind of rough on me for about 5 minutes, and then he got a lot more cool.
That reminds me of a good story. I got to tell this one real quick. God help me why this happened. My friend Jean Johnson, she's Jean Johnson now, she was Jean McDonald then. Jeannie was a record rep locally, and she was working for Arista at the time, which was Barry Manilow's label. And only because Jean was one of my best friends, she got me to go to the Manilow show, telling me that if I just went backstage and said hello with her, if she had a Cream editor backstage briefly, even at a Manilow show, she said this would be incredibly important in her career. So I said, okay, sure, whatever. I went down and I went back there. I swear I'm not making this up. He came out wearing rollers. He had pink rollers in his hair. He had rollers in his hair. So it's like, okay, here she, you know, Susan Whitehall for Cream Magazine. I'm shaking. We didn't even get to the shaking hand part because he gets this look of disgust on his face. And I got to see if I can say this in a family-friendly way. He said, "You're Cream Magazine, you're the rag. You're the assholes who actually called me a putz in print. A putz. What kind of magazine uses the word putz?" I'm like, whoa. I'm like, Gene, why did you do this to me? What am I doing back here with this jerk I don't like? And he's screaming at me wearing pink rollers. How can you use the word putz? Of course I knew what he was. It had to have been something Lester wrote. It was. Anyway. Yep, I was there.
For a while, he was really sweet, very nice, wrote his set list by hand. And I think John Deacon was there. And I kept asking everybody, "Where's Freddie?" And it was like the question you weren't supposed to ask. Everybody would like stare at the shoes and look at the ceiling and say, "Oh, you know, Freddie's off with his friends." And I, you know, I'd be like, "What are they talking about?" Well, now I can kind of figure, you know, he was in some other hotel room swinging from the chandeliers probably or something. But it was just so strange that they were like so.
Well, I was at a, I don't know, I think I was at a different party for Queen, but we were talking to Brian May, and were you there, Bill?
No, that was before me.
You were there?
Yes, I was.
Well, we were talking to Brian, and Brian was really mad at Cream. He was going, "Why do you guys always make fun of Freddie for being gay? Why do you say that he's gay? What makes you think that?" Just at that very moment, Freddie came into the room. It was a buffet at the Hyatt Regency, and he twirled and did an arabesque. I'm like, I don't know why we think he's gay.
All the time. The only thing I wanted to add about that Springsteen story, if you remember, we went down in the basement and we were all standing around, and he said, "So what are you guys doing?"
So what are you guys doing?
Yeah, we're like, whatever
you're doing.
In Greektown. He goes, "Can I go?"
What do you mean, can you go?
Band? He's like, no, everybody goes and does their own thing. So we went to leave, and there was like how many hundreds of people back of Masonic Auditorium. And by God, he took the time to like sign every single thing. And mind you, he'd already played like three hour concert.
Yeah. And we're all going, like, "Come on, man, we're going to the restaurant."
And we're trying to steer him, and then he's hopping up on the trucks and running around the parking lot. And it's like, Jesus, you couldn't corral the guy, you know.
Yeah.
But anyway.
And then we drove him to Greektown in your crappy car.
I had a 1972 Mercury Monterey Brougham. The thing was like a battleship. It fit like 20
And I'm thinking as we're driving, you know, I'm thinking of the headlines. Rock star dies in beater car.
It went around the corner like a ship, like listing, you know. Anyway, it was
and then we get
to
Great.
Back to the Weston.
Then we, he insisted on walking back to his hotel. Yes. We said, no, you're not. We walked with him.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Sky Daniels had that big, like, Devo jumpsuit on. The guy was, like, 6 foot six. So, we've got Springsteen and the rest of our Motley crew, and then Sky Daniels in this giant yellow Devo jumpsuit. Lumbering along.
Nice image, yeah.
If I could interject.
This is Larry Kaplan. He was a Cream photographer for a long time. Talking to the microphone.
Yes, and I forgot to, like, dismantle it before the car went.
Oh, yeah. Bruce didn't have a penny on it. He was very apologetic.
We had to buy Bruce's dinner.
I still regret bailing because they're like, come on, we're going out with Bruce Springsteen. I'm like, I don't really like Bruce, and I'm tired, I'm going to go home. And now it's like, what was I thinking?
Hi, my name's Eric Phillips. I'm from the suburbs. I grew up in Milford. The mystique of rock and roll was like a religion to me, and Cream was like the Bible, you know. So, I mean, we pored over the pages, and it was such a great thing. But the thing that really endeared it to me was the photo captions. I mean, we would laugh our asses off at these photo captions, you know. And I always wondered if you took a lot of crap from the artists about some of the photo captions.
Well, she reminded
I don't think we took crap from them. I think they enjoyed it. It's one thing that we didn't mention about Cream that even though we made fun of a lot of artists, a lot of groups, and we gave them bad reviews, they'd still want to be in Cream, most notably Journey. Journey probably kept us alive for several years with their full-color back page ads in Cream, and yet we pummeled them mercilessly. We never gave them a good review.
I do have one story about that. I was sitting in the office one afternoon. I was the only one there, and they buzz in, and they say, Billy Joel on line one. We used to get calls all the time that they weren't really the people, so I picked it up and said, hi, Bill, editorial. He said, you know, you people make fun of me all the goddamn time, and what it was a caption of Chrissy Brinkley, who he was dating at the time, and she was waving, and it said, dating a moron, question why I am. So... So they said, you make fun of me all the time. I'm like, well, we make fun of everybody. We make fun of ourselves. You know, we're not picking on you. Well, it's one thing when you pick on me, but when you pick on my girlfriend, that's another thing. I said, Billy, she was calling you the moron. We were calling her the moron. So I said, you know, actually, I like some of your stuff, just to calm them down a little bit. I said, but the person that wrote the caption isn't here right now, so I figured I'd toss it off on Dave DiMartino. I said, call back later and ask for Dave. He did call back, and Wendy Warren was on the phones that day, and Wendy said, oh, they're in a meeting right now, so that's how important Billy Joel was to us that day.
So. Oh, I have to interject one thing. I see my brothers Scott and Robert, and my sister-in-law's Shirley and Marisa are there, and I have to point out my dad, my beloved dad. When I first started at Cream, and I was only there for a few months, my parents weren't quite sure what was going on with this, and one day, Jan and I were down on the floor kind of proofreading. She liked to lay on the floor when she was doing that, and so I did too. He came up, and it was like he just made a sneak visit. He wanted to see what we were doing. And, you know, it's like, Dad, what are you doing here? But, you know, he saw that everything, we really were editing. We really were putting a magazine out. So he was cool, and he never did that again. Lex Cooney, who was a columnist for the Metro Times and a lawyer, entertainment lawyer.
Hi, guys. You know, all of my Detroit Cream friends, all my alumni, it's just always been fun getting to know you guys over the years, and even people online.
I have two editorial questions, though, that I always wondered about. The one non-Detroit name that you saw a lot was Robert Christgau, and I loved Christgau's Consumer Guide. How did Christgau end up in Cream, because those things were so incredible, you know. I ultimately ended up doing music reviews, and doing 80-word music reviews and a grade are so hard, you know, to boil it down the way he did. How did you end up with Christgau in the pages?
Christgau,
And was there any connection with Village Voice?
No connection with Village Voice that I know of. Christgau was already in place by the time I came along, so I can't tell you why Ben might have been able to. He just, there he is.
Ben?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
Amazing. Like, his reviews were always great.
The one funny, Barry Strike can tell you about that column, though, is that we used to act up and do strange things and have weird things in the copy, and Bob was sort of a kind of a liberal and kind of, you know, well, this is what Barry said. He was afraid we would anger Chris Gow with some of the crazy stuff we had in the issue, and he would sometimes worry about that. But go on.
And then the second one was, I know that the Cream profiles were ultimately a parody of the Doers profiles. Does anybody know what the genesis of that was? And who wrote them? Because those were flippin' hilarious.
Well,
those were always funny.
The editors wrote them. It was a takeoff on the Doers profiles, but Connie.
We need you on a microphone, Connie. Yeah, it was straight up parody.
Yeah, yeah, and we just had so much fun writing those. That was big fun. Almost, and, you know, the cut lines, right. All of it was fun.
Were there any feedbacks, either positive or negative, that were memorable from those?
On the
profiles?
Because
those were hilarious, because those weren't always kind.
Well, I mean, the Grace Slick was a little edgy, but
they all really wanted it. From what I know.
They all wanted to be in it. Yeah, we had no problem getting them. Obviously, yeah. Gilda did that was the best when she had her little boy Howdy on. Yep. Gilda was friends growing up, went to school with Connie, and so that was great because we had an in when the Blues Brothers came to town. We got to go, and in fact, I took my brother Kevin backstage, I remember, at the after party. You have a question?
I just want to know if any of you guys lived in that house in Birmingham.
Ben did, didn't you? Brown Street?
On Brown Street. You probably don't remember. I lived there for about 6 or 7 weeks on the couch.
Uh-oh.
Are you Nick Kent? And, no, I'm not.
Nick.
And Connie, you threw me out of Cream on more than one occasion. I used to go there for free albums and try to, you know, scrounge up some tickets to stuff. You don't remember me. I'm Harvey Zupke's nephew, David.
Oh.
It was absolutely the coolest place to hang out when you were a teenager.
Yeah.
Especially if you liked pot. Not that I did. It was a great place, and Lester Bangs was a very interesting guy to a young kid.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, we literally would spend all day at work, and then we'd go... eat a Pasquale's, and nobody ever wanted to go home. It was more fun than going home. Alan Stamm, my former colleague at the Detroit News, he was an editor there for years.
Did you ever poke at Rolling Stone in print? Certainly in conversations in the office you must have, but did you ever prank them or punk them?
You know.
You challenged them to a band, didn't you?
to a battle of the bands one time, yeah. I recall that. You know, they were sort of such an easy target that I don't know that we really mentioned them a lot. It would be too self-referential.
They were a bunch of pussies.
They were a bunch of pussies, yeah. They were. I think we threw Family Friendly out a long time ago
did
here.
Did you try to cut deals with artists where we'll put you on the cover if you don't do a cover of Rolling Stone?
No. I'm glad you brought that up because when I was editor, I'd get the publicist calling up to say, hey, do you want an interview with blah, blah? But you have to put them on the cover in order to get the interview. I'd say, no, we'll decide what's going to be on the cover. And that would be a hard-fought battle between, you know, Barry and the editors, what would go on the cover. We're not going to let the record company decide. And they would say, but Rolling Stone does that. They give cover approval. I go, well, we don't. And it was so easy. I don't know why Rolling Stone would do something like that. All you had to say was, no, we're not going to do it. And we didn't do it, and we found most of the bands wanted to be interviewed by us and in the issue anyway, so it wasn't a problem.
Okay, so I don't mean to monopolize, but there's one other thing I think everybody would find really entertaining.
This is Alan Madeline, former Cream editorial assistant.
We used to have a picture file that Charlie was kind enough to to show me one time.
Uh-oh, the X-rated file.
Yeah, and I always wondered what happened to those pictures, but the four that stick in my mind were, we had a picture of Emerson, Lake, and Palmer
water skiing
buck naked, the three of them. Behind a boat, taken off the back of the boat, like water skiing naked.
Now, what on earth? I know. I used to think, what were they thinking? And how did we get the picture?
We had Brian Eno buck naked on a bed, and all I can remember is the guy was hung like a mule. It was incredible. There was a picture of...
Martin Mull, too. We had him.
Oh, I didn't. Now, that one I don't remember, but yeah. We had Ruby Starr, who used to sing with Black Oak Arkansas, with her foot up on a monitor, like an upskirt with no underwear.
Yeah.
I remember that one. Yeah. And then Sable Starr, the groupie, who was probably like 14, topless in the back of a convertible, like that somebody was driving. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, whatever. What became of all those wonderful...
That's his story, and he's sticking to it. So there's a lot more stories and all. We're going to be at the museum talking and telling stories, so come on over. It's going to be fun. You really get to see the exhibit. It's kind of fun to see the narrative.
Wow, thanks, Susan, all of the other creamsters who contributed, all the people in the audience. We could go on and on. I wish we had more time, but, you know, that's part of what we're all about today is just to get together, remember, and I want to invite you at this point to leave the library behind because we have to move along, but you're all welcome to come over to the museum. The museum, if you don't know, it's over on Maple Road. It's a few blocks only walk. And come in the visitor entrance. There is a minor admission, which will help the museum out. So we're asking for you to keep that in mind as you come in. We'll be there until 4:00 today, and you're all welcome to come. Please come and see the exhibit. If you can't come today, come back again. It'll be up until the end of February. Thank you, everybody.
Yeah, let me get this off first.